morning. Welcome. Everybody stand and we'll sing a song to praise God for working all things out. Amen.
Amen.
There's a line in that song that says, I choose to praise. That's what we're doing. We're choosing to praise. Things are different. Things are a little off in our world, or a lot off, and it feels maybe even just a little different being in here this morning, or you're having to watch it online instead of getting to be here in person. Well, we still have a choice to make. We can grumble and complain, but I told my son the other day, you know what happened to the people of Israel and they grumbled and complained? The earth opened up and swallowed them. So let's not choose that. Let's choose to praise. We choose, no matter what circumstances, to give glory to our God. So I'm very glad to be here. Why don't you just, right where you are, just kind of turn. Remember, you got to keep your masks on, all that. But turn and wave and say hi to everybody here. We can even wave and say hi to the people in the camera. You may go ahead and be seated. I just have one announcement this morning to make sure that I share with you all. The quarterly business meeting is Sunday, August 23rd at 12:15. And we are having it in person here in the sanctuary. There's no RSVP that's necessary for that. Hopefully we'll have a quorum, enough people here to be able to vote on any matters that we have for the church. But that's coming up. Quarterly business meeting Sunday, August 23rd at 12:15 p.m. And yes, I know the slide only says M, but it's p.m., not a.m. So don't come at 12:15 a.m. looking for anything. And then just a reminder, those of you who are here already know, but if you're watching us online, we are having two in-person worship services now going forward, Lord willing, at 9 and at 11, and we've had room, so please do RSVP and come and join us either at 9 or 11 in person to worship together. Isn't it good to be able to do it together in person? Amen. Amen. I'm going to go ahead and invite up Pastor Ken to lead us now in a word of prayer, and as he concludes, he'll lead us in the Lord's Prayer.
The series that Pastor Stephen is sharing is getting to know God, and he certainly already knows us. But prayer is one way of getting to know God, and he hears our prayers, and he answers our prayers. So let's be thankful for that as we bow our heads. Lord, Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the opportunity to worship you together again with folks that are here live and our doors open and worshiping together. Also those who are online and live streaming, we thank you and we are praying for you as well. Lord, a couple special prayers this morning for Sue Dufresne as she has a very bad ankle right now. She got either bitten or some kind of rash, and it's very, very sore, and she's going to the doctors right after the first service that we had. And I also want to pray for a dear friend, for those who know Karen MacArthur at the Overlook. She's there, and she's very sick right now and poor in health, and you know, whether it's 2 weeks from now or 6 weeks from now, she is declining, and we pray for her, just for peace for her. We know she has salvation in you, and that's one thing we can claim and know and praise you for, and we just ask for those prayers to be heard for them and their families, for comfort and for peace. Lord, we pray for our continued church schedule as it goes forward. We pray for all the loved ones in our church who need you right now in one way or another. We all need you, Lord. And just grant us peace and the confidence in you that you're in control in all things. And Lord, as we worship this morning through the music, through your word, may it empower us and change our hearts very specifically, Lord, to each day be more like you. Thank you, Lord, for those who have congregated this morning. May we our hearts be filled with joy in serving you and singing to you and ministering to each other again. What a wonderful day this is again. And Lord, let us also pray the prayer that you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. morning, everyone. It's such a joy to be able to be together, to worship together at church. I'm so thankful for that, and to have two services this morning, and also to be able to worship together online. Our scripture reading this morning is going to be from Isaiah chapter 44, verses 6 through 8. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first, and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Who is like me? Let him proclaim it. Let him declare and set it before me, since I appointed an ancient people. Let them declare what is to come and what will happen. Fear not, nor be afraid. Have I not told you from of old and declared it? And you are my witnesses. Is there a God besides me? There is no rock. I know not any. Isaiah chapter 44, verses 6 through 8, the word of the Lord.
Last week, we began a new series called Knowing God, and it's a series focusing on the attributes of God, who he is. So for the next several weeks, we're going to be looking at the Bible that teaches us various aspects of God's character, his nature, his person, his actions. So we're going to be, hopefully, gaining knowledge about God. But knowing, having more knowledge, is not the goal. Let me say that again. I do want you to learn things. I'm hoping that when we are done with 5 or 6 week series, you feel like there's things you didn't know about God before that now you know. So I hope that you learn some things. But that's not the goal or the aim or the purpose of this series on knowing God. The goal of studying God is to know him personally. And the goal of knowing God isn't even ultimately the direction we're going, but so that we can love him and delight in God. So our goal is to be intoxicated with God. Our goal is to be overwhelmed, enraptured, amazed by God at the very core of our being. Our goal, anything short of loving the Lord our God with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, all of our strength, anything short of that fails to honor God as he truly deserves. And so our goal is, yes, we want to learn some stuff, but we want to learn stuff so that we know the person. We know God. And in knowing God, we want to love him with our whole heart and delight in him with everything that we are. So the challenge for me and the challenge for you is to move beyond knowing about God to knowing God. That essentially is a recap of what we looked at last week. That was the focus. And this week we are going to begin by looking at the attributes of God today, specifically beginning by looking at what I've phrased God's utter uniqueness. It's utter uniqueness. He is not like anyone or anything else. Now that's not saying it that way isn't exactly how you're going to find it in the theology textbooks. If you've ever looked at a systematic theology and it goes through the attributes of God, you probably won't find one that says God, the uniqueness of God. But I think it's a very biblical way of understanding how God communicates himself to us. He says time and time again, there's no one like me. There is no one or no thing that can be compared to me. He is God, and there is no other. There is none like him. Before we dive into looking at these together, would you bow your head in a word of prayer with me? Father, I thank you for speaking to us, because all we would have is guesses. We may be able to figure a few basic things out. Your word tells us we would know that there is a creator, and that we are accountable to that creator, but beyond that, we would know so little. And yet your word speaks. You have chosen to communicate to us, your creatures. And you have given us the word of God, And here we have sure and true and absolute knowledge of you, and we take it as a gift. And Lord, may this make our minds come alive, and even more, our hearts be bursting with joy and love for you, because you have communicated to us and invited us, in fact, to know you. So this morning, Lord, may the words of my mouth not just be my ideas. May they be your word, and may they be pleasing to you. And may the meditations of our hearts, the thoughts that we have, not just be ideas, but may they be from the depth of our souls, love for you, and may be pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Amen. I want to begin by telling you a story from the Bible. Some of you will know it, and you'll sort of nod your heads knowingly. Others, maybe it's the first time you've heard it. It's from Exodus chapter 32, and it's sometimes referred to as the story of the golden calf. Israel had been just weeks earlier, at most, delivered from slavery, from generations of slavery in Egypt. God had stepped in, and with a powerful and miraculous hand, after doing curses or plagues over Egypt that essentially ravaged the country, they said, "You slaves, be gone. We want nothing to do with you." They changed their mind. The army chased after them, and God destroyed the strongest army the world knew at that time, and he destroyed them in the Red Sea. The people of Israel safely rescued and brought to Mount Sinai. So this seems like a great time to be a lover of God, right? This is the time when things are going well, you're excited, you have seen God, he's tangible to you. You saw the frogs, you saw the flies, you saw him destroy the firstborn. You know he's real. And so that Israel encamps around Mount Sinai, and God calls up Moses, his leader, the leader of his people. He calls him up, and he begins to talk to Moses and to give him the law. But that mountaintop must have been kind of high, surrounded with clouds, because the people couldn't see Moses. And he was staying up there longer than they thought that he should, and they started to get worried and anxious and fearful. And so they come to Aaron, Moses' brother. Aaron was number two in charge. God said, "Moses, if you're afraid to talk, I'm going to talk to you. You tell Aaron, he'll tell the people." So Aaron is one of the leaders, top leaders of God's people. And they come to Aaron and they say, "We don't know what's happened to Moses. We don't know what to do. We're scared. Make us an idol so we can worship and know what we're dealing with." And Aaron, in what can only be a moment of madness, agrees to this. This is the guy who saw the snake, saw the staff turn into a snake, saw the Nile turn to blood, experienced the power of God, and they come to him and they say, "You need to make us an idol so we can worship our God." And he says, "Okay." And they put together all their gold and they make a cow. They make a cow out of gold. And then Aaron has the audacity to say to the people, "Behold your God who rescued you from slavery." Meanwhile, Moses is up on the mountain. And he comes down and sees what's going on because he heard them and their false worship. And he sets them straight, sort of. Many people had to die as a result. They crushed that idol into dust and he made them put it in the water and drink it. Which reminds me of when my sister put pepper in my breakfast cereal once. And when I discovered it, my mom made her drink it or eat it all. So he made them eat it, and it was bitter. But how could this be? And it's easy for us. We think, that is just ridiculous. You saw the living God, and then you chose to make a cow. And yet time and time again, do we not do the same thing where we seek to exchange the one true living God for something familiar? For something safe, for something that makes sense to us, something that's manageable, something that's reasonable, maybe something that other people will find attractive. And we replace God with an idol or an image. But there is only one God. And he can't be compared to any idol we make. In fact, God in the Ten Commandments, the second one says, "You shall not make any idol." Now, I always read that as a kid. I just thought that meant don't make any false idols like of other gods. But he, of course, God is saying that. Don't have other gods. He just said that in the first commandment. You have no other gods before me. And then he says, "You shall not make any idols." He's talking especially about don't make idols for me. Because there is something, and God knows human nature, and there is something in human nature that as soon as we craft that thing and we identify it with God, what we have done is we take God, who cannot be known in his fullness, who is bigger than anything we can imagine, and we shrink him down to size. And to use the modern phrase, we put him in a box that we understand. Oh, a cow looks strong and powerful. It's a bull, and other nations have gods like that. And our God's strong, so let's make him into a bull. And then you begin to worship, and your image of God becomes the bull instead of the living God. And so he put a prohibition against it because there is only one God, and he is unlike anything or anyone that we can imagine. He's utterly unique and one of a kind. And this is a truth that's all throughout scriptures. It's not a one-off in the Ten Commandments or Exodus 32. It's all throughout scripture. In fact, the first time that God spoke to Moses, and Moses said, you know, God told him, go free my people. Moses says, well, who am I going to tell him sent me? And God reveals his name. He reveals how he wants to be known by his people. And in Exodus 3, chapter 14, God said to Moses, I am who I am. He refused, in other words, I think at that stage, he refused to be shrunk down into anything else. And even just by giving a name to God, if we give it to him, it has the temptation then for us to shrink and minimize God. Now listen, he does, of course, give us all kinds of analogies and illustrations to help us grasp different aspects of who he is. In fact, we just sang about one. Good, good Father. That's an illustration. That's a picture that's given to us so that we can get some sense of who God is. But the moment that we begin to say that is our God in total, and if we ever to make a statue of a father and say, let's put this in the place of worship so we know what we're worshiping, we begin to shrink God. And he says, I am who I am. I am like nothing else and can be compared to no one else. I do think, as scholars will say, that he was also talking very much about his self-existence, that no one created him, that he himself has always existed. I think that's a huge part of that name and its meaning. But I think in this context as well, thinking about it, it's God saying, I am utterly unique, completely different. Don't compare me to anything. I am who I am. And so then he says, say to this people of Israel, I am, and I should have on the slide put that in all caps, say, I am has sent me to you. So God is declaring his uniqueness. Deuteronomy 6, chapter 6, verse 4 is another one of these crucial verses for the people of Israel. In fact, it has a name. It's so commonly said. It's a daily prayer. It's called the Shema, which is the Hebrew word for hear, because it begins with, hear, O Israel. They're proclaiming. They say this verse over and over to each other, to themselves. They're proclaiming to one another, hear, O Israel, listen. This is what we're going to tell you about our God. This is what I'll speak to my own soul about who you are, God. And it says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God. It could be translated just as well, the Lord is our God. The Lord is one. Now again, just like the I am, I mean, it is packed with all kinds of things that teaches us about God. I want to just draw out one element. He is saying, the Lord is one, and there's none other like him. You do not worship many gods. There are not many gods. There is only one God, and he is our God. He is the Lord. So God is unique. He's alone. He's one of a kind in all of his characteristics, all of his attributes. 1 Samuel chapter 2, this is Hannah's prayer. If you know the story, Hannah had prayed to God and asked for a child because she was barren. God blessed her with a child, Samuel. And so in response, she spoke this prayer. And in verse 2 of chapter 2 in 1 Samuel, she said, there is none holy like the Lord. There is none besides you. There is no rock like our God. And so we're going to explore in a few minutes this idea that there is none, not only is God unique in his identity, he is unique in his character of being perfectly righteous and holy. None other, no other person, no other thing, no other God is holy or righteous like he is. Jesus proclaimed this as well about the one true God. We saw this last week, John chapter 17, verse 3. Jesus is praying to the Father, but he's praying out loud so that his disciples will hear him. And so he's praying and teaching at the same time. And he says this, and he said in verse 3, and this is eternal life, that they know you. The they is Jesus' followers, and the you is God. And he says that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. There is only one God. There is only one unique God over all things, one true God. I remember we had a VBS, I think the last couple of years, in the curriculum of the VBS. I really liked the way they phrased it because the kids were learning that they were taken sort of back in time. And one year it was Daniel in the lion's den. And they lived in a culture there, Daniel and his friends, when there were many, many gods. And so the way they distinguished their God, and the kids picked up on this, is they said the one true God. All the others are fakes, phonies, and liars. There is one true God. And then one last verse here just to show sort of the breadth of Scripture that speaks this same word, that there is only one God. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. Paul wrote this letter to Timothy, and it's a practical letter that has all kinds of instructions for how Timothy should lead the church as a pastor there. But he can't help himself. And so as he's writing this to Timothy and he's saying all these important things about God, it just spills over into praise and into prayer. And so in 1 Timothy 1:17, it's a prayer coming off of the lips of Paul. He says, to the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. There is one God. And then where we're going to spend most of our time this morning is in Isaiah. Isaiah chapters 40 through 46, we'll just pick out some highlighted verses from that section. But in this section of Isaiah, God's prophet, Isaiah, is hearing from the Lord, and he has a message to the people of Israel. And in a sense, he is calling them and challenging them to say, would you dare follow after any other God? I am the only true and living God. And so as we look at Isaiah, we're going to see God's uniqueness in four ways. We're going to look specifically this morning, the remainder of our time, four different ways that God is unique. God is the only creator. God is the only authority. God is the only righteous one, which I mentioned already, and he is the only savior. We're beginning with this idea that God and God alone is the creator. The Bible just assumes that. It takes it from the first page. If you've ever picked up a Bible and said, this is the year, I'm going to read through the whole Bible. And you say, well, let's start at the beginning, right? Where else will I start? And you turn the pages to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. Right off the bat, what we have is the declaration that there is only one God and he created everything. So Genesis 1:1 says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And he says, the heavens and the earth, this is his way of being inclusive of everything. The things that are right in front of you, that you know, that you can touch, even the things far off in the atmosphere that you can't see all of, or maybe you see as a shining light and nothing more. He says, all of it created by God. But the only thing that's not created in this passage is God himself. He's always existed. And yet he is also the one who's brought everything from the smallest molecule or atom or part of an atom to the most powerful spiritual being apart from God himself, the strongest of angels. God created all of these things. And the New Testament affirms the same thing and then actually sort of steps back and broadens the scope to help us understand that when God did it through his son, Jesus, who is also God, who is one with the Father. And so John chapter 1 says, all things were made through him. All things. So what part of all is there that doesn't fit? It's all things. But just in case you missed it, John goes on to say, after he says, all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Whenever I read that, it feels awkward. Like, I don't think my English teacher would like that very much if I said it that way. But one thing that comes out of that is you can't miss it, that he's saying there ain't nothing that God didn't make. He and he alone is the creator of all things. And so Isaiah, knowing this deep biblical truth, speaking the words that God gives him, affirm this over and over. So let's look. We're going to be in a lot of passages in Isaiah, so I'll have most of them up there on the overhead. If you've got your Bible open to somewhere between Isaiah 40 and 46, you might be able to follow along with me. Let's look first at Isaiah 40, verses 22 and 23. God says this, or actually it is said about God, it is he who sits above the circle of the earth. Now, when that's an image that we don't use anymore because we have a different understanding of what the universe's makeup is. And so we know that there's not a circle of the world and God sits above it. But this is language that communicated very clearly that there is a God who is over all things. There is a God who is above and superior to all created things. And it describes him as one who, it says that he sits above the circle of the earth. Its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, kind of giving us a perspective of how great God is and how small we are. It describes God as the one who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in. This is imagery of him being the one who created it and populated it and gave it as a place for us to live. God is the creator. And then just two verses later in verse 25, it says, God, he's throwing down the gauntlet. He's challenging him. He says, so who do you think's like me? There's no one like me. And so he says, to whom, verse 25, to whom then will you compare me that I should be like him, says the Holy One. And then as a way to prove it, he says, just look around. Can any other creature do what the Creator has done? He says, lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? And he's pointing to the heavens, and it's easier to do at night. You can look at all the stars there. But he looks up and he says, who created these heavens? Who brings out their hosts? That's another name here for stars. Who, in other words, brings out the stars by number, calling them all by name? And the clear answer is nobody. Not Baal, the god that some of the nations around Israel could have, that they worshiped, or the gods of Babylon. None of them have created everything that we see. And it says, by the greatness of his might and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. And then one more verse here that he says in verse, this is chapter 44, moving forward a couple chapters in verse 24, he says, thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, who formed you from the womb, I am the Lord, I'm the master, I'm the ruler, and he says, who made all things. Can you get more clear than that? God made all things, who alone stretched out the heavens and who spread out the earth by myself. Now, you see, we live in an age in which creativity is off the charts right now. Right? I mean, we are seeing a pace of development of new ideas, new technology, new understanding that is incomparable to anything that's come before. And so certainly the modern scientific study of nature has resulted in some amazing discoveries, some wonderful inventions, and we might be tempted to say has created all kinds of great things. But that wouldn't be the right language to use. Because they really have created, no scientist in a lab, no engineer working on a computer or a carpenter building something, none of them have created in the sense that God creates. You see, even Dolly the sheep. Some of you remember Dolly the sheep? This was the first cloned animal, if I understand correctly. In other words, they were able to take a living sheep and create a perfectly identical one. And I say create, right? That's just the normal way we use the language. But when you think about it, it doesn't compare to the way God created, because they still needed the raw material of DNA. They had to start with something. And then sure, it's amazing what they did, but it doesn't compare to God, who started with nothing, and he spoke, and it happened. Only God has that power. If they ever create life in a test tube, if they're able to put together molecules in such a way that it comes alive and it has the characteristics of life, it still will be a distant second to the reality that God breathed life into the man, and he became a living being out of nothing. He gives life. He creates. Only our God creates like that. And so to, pardon me, to make anything that is created into our God is foolishness. It's stupidity. And that's what Isaiah wants us to get in the next passage I'm going to read you in Isaiah 44. He wants to show how absurd it is to take something that God created and turn that into our God. And so he gives this example. He says in verse 13 of chapter 44, he says, the carpenter stretches a line. He marks it out with a pencil. He shapes it with planes, marks it with a compass. He shapes it into the figure of a man with the beauty of a man to dwell in a house. He's describing a craftsman making an idol, making it out of wood. It says he cuts down cedars, or he chooses a cypress tree or an oak and lets it grow strong among the trees of the forest. He plants a cedar and the rain nourishes it. Then, so you get the picture here. He's starting to describe how this process happens. First, you find the right tree. You let it grow up and it's nice and big and strong. And then you cut it down. And it says, then it becomes fuel for a man. Right? As you take a tree, many of you still heat your houses with wood and you have cords of wood. There it is. He says, you cut down this tree. And with part of it, he says, it becomes fuel. He takes a part of it and warms himself. He kindles a fire and bakes bread. So you use it to cook with. And it says, half of it he burns in the fire. Over the half he eats meat. He roasts it and satisfied. Also he warms himself and says, ah, I am warm. I have seen the fire. And then listen to this. And the rest of it he makes into a god, his idol, and falls down to it and worships it. He prays to it and says, deliver me, for you are my God. He says, isn't it ridiculous to think the same stuff that you're burning in your fireplace somehow is a god? That's not the God of the Scriptures. He can't be contained. He can't be even understood or seen or replicated with a piece of wood, with the same material that will rot and decay given enough time. Our God is unique. It's absurd to fashion a god out of the same thing. And so a lot of us go, that is so foolish. Who would do that? You know, we don't have idols like that. That's crazy. And say, yeah, we have idols. They have faces, like George Washington. Or you like the ones with Benjamin Franklin on them more because they're worth a little bit more. Or we have idols, things that are of this world that are created, that are impressive, and we drive in them, and they have a little symbol on the front. And if you've got the right symbol, you've got the right status. And so you look to those things to lift you up, to elevate you. We have idols. We have homes, and we sleep in them. But the bigger it is, the better it's designed, the fancier it looks, the more we feel proud of ourselves. We turn these things into gods. And God says it's foolishness. There is only one God. I created all those things. I gave you the materials to make a car out of. It cannot replace me. There is only one true and living God. And he alone is the creator of all things. So that's the first thing, that the uniqueness. As we think about God's uniqueness, he's the only one who can do it. He's the only one who can create. The second thing about his uniqueness is that the one true God is the only authority. He's the only one with power, true power. He is the only sovereign, right? That's a word that we use in church. Sovereign God, he is sovereign. What it basically means is he has absolute power and authority over all things, and there is nothing else that can challenge that power. Nothing else can compare in power. Every other power is derived power. We talk about in our country that the government derives its power from the will of the people. We are giving permission to our leaders to lead us. So any power they have is only because we agree to give them power. But even on a grander scale, if somebody tries to abuse that and they take control and they think they have power, any power they have is only derived from God. Secondary and not even comparable, but like a drop in the ocean, a drop of water. So God is the only one who has true authority and power. And he demonstrates that in lots of different ways. And what he's going to do in Isaiah is he's going to demonstrate it by saying, now take your false gods and have them tell you what's going to happen in the future. Good luck with that. I can do it because I have authority over the future. I have the power to do whatever I say, so I can tell you what I'm going to do, and it will happen. So Isaiah 46, God speaks this way. He says, remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, things not yet done. He's saying, I, as the one with true power and authority, can tell you long before they happen what's going to happen. And he's done that at various times in the scriptures. And in fact, we have the ending of the story. And we can quibble and get confused over all the details, but I guarantee you this. When God unravels the end of the age, it's going to unfold just like he said. And maybe we'll go, oh, that's what you meant with, ah, oh, but it's all going to come true just how he says. Because he sees the end from the beginning. And then he goes on to say, my counsel shall stand and I will accomplish my purpose. He's saying, nothing can stop me. You can't stop me from doing the things that I'm going to do because I have power and authority. And when we think about God as the one who can tell the future, I don't want you to minimize it to something like the Zoltar machine. Do you remember this? Some of you have seen this. Grew up in like the nickel arcades, and you could get your future told to you by Zoltar. You know, I will tell you your future or something like that. But I read on the internet, so it pops out one of 21 cards. So I guess there's only 21 ways your future can go. And Zoltar, he can't tell you. It just shows you that we sort of joke with it, but some people really invest, not in Zoltar, but in money, in trying to understand and know the future, and only God can do it. And in some ways, we see it, and it's blatantly wicked. You go to a fortune teller, a psychic, and you say, tell me, I need to know what's going to happen. We also do it in more benign ways, that in and of themselves aren't bad until we begin to have the pride and hubris that says we know what's going to happen. So, for example, you turn on CNBC and you will have all kinds of talking heads telling you what's going to happen in the markets tomorrow, what's going to happen a year from now. Oh, we know. We see the trends. We can figure it all out. And God says, you don't know nothing. I am the only God who has all authority, who knows the future. And he even challenges the false gods. Prove yourselves. So again, in chapter 41, verses 21 through 24, he says, set forth your case. It says, Lord, bring your proofs. Say, says the king of Jacob, let them bring them and tell us what is to happen. Tell us the former things, what they are, that we may consider them, that we may know their outcome. Or declare to us the things to come. He says, tell us what is to come hereafter, that we may know that you are gods. You want to prove it. Show us what's going to happen. And then let it happen, and we'll believe you. But then he knows they can't do that. And I like how he says next, do good or do bad. Just do something so that we see that you really have power. And in comparison to God, it all falls short. And he says, you know, do harm, do good, that we may be dismayed and terrified. And then he says his judgment, his verdict, behold, you are nothing. And your works are less than nothing. And you say, how can something be less than nothing? That can't mathematically, but what he means is not only are your works, they're nothing because you're nothing, but the little power you have that wields something that then you can say, oh, look, I made this, or I did this, or I figured out this was going to happen. He says they're worse than nothing because they're abominations. Because it's you and your presumptuous pride saying we have control and we have power. And he says, so the things you do are nothing. They're worse than nothing. They are an abomination. Our God, and only our God, has absolute power and authority. The third thing. So God alone is creator. God alone has authority and power. God alone is truly righteous. Truly righteous. So there's creative power. There's sovereign power that uniquely belong to God, but he's also morally unique. Meaning in the categories of how he thinks, acts, behaves, feels, he is in a category of his own. That's what it means in essence to say God is holy, not like anyone else, perfect and pure. He is the only truly righteous one. So again, 1 Samuel chapter 2, what did it say? There is none holy like the Lord. And Isaiah is going to pick up on that same thing, and I should say God speaking through Isaiah, and he's going to declare that he is righteous, that he speaks truth, that he does what is right, and that he alone is the one who can judge with equity and justice. So Isaiah 45, verse 18, thus says the Lord who created the heavens, he is God, who formed the earth and made it. He established it. He did not create it empty. He formed it to be inhabited. That God says, I am the Lord and there is no other. And he says, I did not speak in secret in a land of darkness. I did not say to the offspring of Jacob, seek me in vain. I think what he's trying to say there is, I'm not duplicitous. I'm not saying one thing but not really meaning it. Everything that comes out of my mouth is truth. And so the very next line he says, I, the Lord, speak truth. I declare what is right. He only speaks what is true and right. And you know, it actually goes further than that, because it's not simply that there's an outside code of morality and God keeps it better than the rest of us. He is actually the one that declares what is right and what is true. And then he is perfectly in line with it all the time. So that he will never one day say, this is right, and the other day say, never mind, that's wrong, now this is right. He speaks truth. And only our God has that kind of righteousness and consistency and integrity. Every other being will fail and fall short. But God speaks, and it's truth. And so he declares himself in Isaiah 45, verse 21, there at the end of that verse, he says, he is a righteous God. I also like Psalm 50, verse 6. This says, the heavens declare his righteousness. In other words, even the world is showing us that God is just and he is righteous, and he is himself a judge. For God himself is judge. So he's righteous, and I think of that, as I've said, sort of in terms of he always does what is right and declares what is right. He's also just. He's a judge who will always be fair and equitable and do the things that are right. There is no human judge like that. You know, as much complaining and grumbling right now about our justice system as there is, I still am in the camp that it's a pretty good system, probably one of the better ones in the world. But even the best justice system in the world is rife with problems. And it's all over the place, and we see it. And so you can go before a judge who one day feels this way and interprets the law this way, and the next day interprets it this way, or one judge says it this way and a different judge says it a different way, or we have Congress write laws and then 5 years later go, oh, no, we have to get rid of that one and do a different one. Our God is not like that. He is righteous and completely true, unchanging and unwavering. That is our God, a righteous God, who is a judge, but will always judge rightly and justly. Which does bring us to the fourth way that God is unique, utterly unique. For the one true God is the only one who can save. There is judgment, but also if we turn to that judge, he can save us. Isaiah 43, verse 10, declaring, he says to his people, you are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe and understand that I am he. Before me no God was formed, nor shall there be any after me. I am the Lord, and beside me there is no Savior, he says. It's almost like he goes in a direction they weren't counting on, because he's been talking about his power, his creativity, his authority. And then he says, but you want to know something else that's unique about me? I and I alone can deliver you. I can save you. And to me, this is where the rubber meets the road for us, because we don't worship those other things, those false idols, because they have inherent power. We think that they're going to save us or give us meaning or purpose or joy. And God says they are all horrible substitutes when you try to make them gods. See, that's an important little caveat. They're good things, perhaps, in themselves. Not the false gods like Baal, but the kinds of things we typically make a god are not always bad in and of themselves. You need a car, you need a house. At least if you live here, you need a car. It's hard to to survive very, very well without somebody in your household having a car, and you need a home and you need money, all those things. As soon as we try to make them our saviors, as soon as we try to have those give us purpose and meaning, they're terrible substitutes that will only lead us into heartache, hurt, ruin, and death. But God says, I can save you. I can rescue you. I can rescue you from sin. I can rescue you from death. I can rescue you from pointlessness and purposelessness. I can rescue you from yourself. Amen? Do you need that? I know I do. God can rescue us, and he invites us to turn to him. So Isaiah 45, verses 21 and 22 says, there is no God besides me, a righteous God and a Savior. There is none beside me. And so he says, turn to me and be saved. And is he just speaking to Israel? Like if you're thinking, if you kind of know the Bible a little bit and go, well, this is Isaiah, so he must be talking to Israel. To make it very clear, he says, turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, even Rochdale, Massachusetts. Turn to me, the one true living God, and you can be saved. He will save us. For I am God, and there is no other. See, we look to the wrong things to save us all the time. I've had the privilege and joy of being able to do a lot of swimming this summer with a family member that has a pool, and we've been invited over to go swimming, and it's been fun. And I'm a pretty good swimmer. I do all right. But even a good swimmer at times can need help or have a problem. And so if I was in the pool and I'm in the deep end where I can't touch and I start having a problem, and if there were two other people in the pool with me, one of them, my 9-year-old son, Jack, and the other, a trained lifeguard, and I start to feel like I'm going under, as much as I love my son, as much as I value him and care for him, in that moment, I'm not going to say, Jack, save me, and then cling to him and we both go down. I'm going to look to the lifeguard because he's the one that knows how to save me. He's the one that has the strength. He's the one that has the training. He's the one that has the eye to watch. And so we so often, instead of looking to the one who can save us, look to everything else and say, oh, maybe sex can save me. Maybe relationships can save me. Maybe politics can save me. Maybe prosperity can save me. And we look to all these other things when God says they will not save you because there is one God, and it is me. Turn to me, all nations, and I can save you. I can rescue you. Is there a God besides me? There is no rock. I know not any. And so you know what he says in Isaiah 42, 17? It says, those who turn to false gods, they are turned back and utterly put to shame, who trust in carved idols, who say to metal images, you are our gods. I don't want to be put to shame. I don't want to find myself at utter ruin and despair because I thought I could find meaning by carving it out for myself or by using other people or by having a cause or by accumulating a lot of money. Only God, when I face that judge, will be able to pardon me. He alone saves, and he does it through his Son, Jesus Christ. And so Jesus told his disciples in John chapter 14, verses 6 and 7, he says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father. That's another way of understanding. No one is saved. No one comes to the Father except through me. And then I love how he tied a bow on it for my sermon series by following it up with this idea that this is how you know God. Because he says, if you had known me, Jesus said to his disciples, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And guess what? From now on you do. Now on you do know the Father because you have seen me. Everything I have said about God that is unique to him is true of Jesus Christ because he is unique three-in-one Godhead. And so Jesus Christ, we look to him, we see the Creator. We see the one with power and authority. We see the one who is perfect without sin and is righteous in all that he does, and we see the one who saves us. I am the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus said. Now I want to leave you with one final thing. When we see God for who he really is, when his glory, I'll say that, glory, understanding it as the beauty of who he is, the beauty of his holiness, the beauty of all of his perfections, all the things we're going to be studying, they have a beauty to them. And when we see that, that is joy that the world cannot give. That is joy that surpasses everything else. The experience of the glory of the one true God is the greatest gift of joy, which is why God wants us to praise him. Do you see that? Do you understand that? He's not an egomaniac that says, boy, I feel bad about myself, and if everybody would just praise me, it would really help me out. No, he says, I know what you need to experience joy. Look to me and my beauty and my glory, and you'll experience joy. And you think, but I need him to do something for me to be happy. No, he does lots of stuff for us, but that's not the ultimate happiness. It's when it brings us to know God and we see him that is joyful. And you know, just a glimpse of that, how that works. A story, 2018, went to Ireland, and we stayed in a town called Dingle. It's a funny name, right? Dingle makes me think of something you would call somebody who's not real smart. You Dingle? So we were in Dingle, and we took this drive. It's in the southwest corner of Ireland. We took this drive one day, leaving out of Dingle. We're kind of going along the coast, but then we cut up and went north over some mountains. And as we went over this big mountain and hill, which had the narrowest road I have ever been on, and it was white-knuckler the whole time, I'm just praying nobody's coming the other way because there's nowhere to go. But we turn the corner, and we see this valley. And this picture does not do it justice. It was just glorious, beautiful valley leading right down to the ocean. And I tell you what, I was filled with joy just at seeing something beautiful. And when we think of God, he makes this valley look like nothing. So being in the presence of God, to take it in, to experience it, to be overwhelmed by him, by his glory, by the beauty of his unique and perfect perfections, that is the joy our heart is longing for. And it is found only in the one true God. Now, right now, we only see a part of it. As well as we can come to know God, we only see in part. That's why Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 12, he says, "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then," pointing to the future, pointing to when we will be with united with God in heaven, or if we are alive when he returns, when we see him and he comes in his glory to recreate heaven and earth and to redeem us, then we see face to face. Now, in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So my encouragement, my challenge to myself and to you is begin to get to know this God. Get those glimpses. Begin more and more to see him for who he truly is. You will love him more, and the promise is there is a day coming of glory when the veil will be completely torn back, and you will see your God, and you will say, well, you probably won't say anything because you'll be flat on your face in awe and wonder, but if you could say anything, you would say, I am so glad that I didn't choose the God of money, sex, relationships, power, cars, job. None of that can bring me this. Only the one true God. Make him your God. Turn from your sin and embrace him as your Savior and your God. Father, thank you for this word. Thank you for the power of your truth. May this 40 minutes that we've sat under the preaching of your word fuel us for the 7 days to come. May we take it with us. May we chew on it, meditate on it, think on it, see your word, and in seeing your word, see you. And may the joy that comes from that help us to persevere through every pain, every heartache, every difficulty, every time we want to rip a mask off our face, every time we're so frustrated we can't be with the ones that we love. Whatever it is, we remember that we have a God who is greater than this, and there is a day when there will be no masks. We will see face to face our God in glory. And let that joy fill us with strength. And Lord, I pray for those who have never tasted even a glimpse of that, that you might save them today, that you would put it upon their hearts to turn from their sins, to turn from any false god that they are pursuing, and turn to you through your Son, Jesus Christ, the only one who saves us, by dying in our place. May they embrace you in faith and be made new, born again in relationship with you. And may it be the beginning of the greatest love story they've ever known. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Would you stand and let me dismiss you with a word? First, I'm going to speak a word of blessing over you. And then for those of you who are still here, I'll ask you to sit down as we dismiss by row at the conclusion of our service. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine upon you. That's just a way of saying may he reveal himself to you and be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. God bless you. Amen. Thank you for joining us on the live stream. Thank you for being here in person. That concludes our service. If you're here, if you would be seated, and then I'll just walk you through it. Although, back row, if you would go ahead and make your way out where Tom is, and you can make your way to your cars. But thank you. And you can talk at this point. Church is over.